It was over 1 year ago when Jesus said these words that we read in the gospel prior to the Feast of Pentecost that we celebrate. It was the Feast of Booths. Feast of Booths is roughly correspondent with our Thanksgiving. It's an ingathering, it's harvest, it's celebration. People come from all over the Mediterranean to make pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Anybody who has a spare bed puts people up. Extended families crowd into small places, and they don't care. They're just happy to see each other. They're happy to be in Jerusalem, and they're happy to celebrate this great and glorious occasion where they commemorate again God taking care of them even in the most difficult times. It's an extraordinary time of rejoicing. Lots of laughter, lots of food, lots of wine. It's a great time in many ways to be in Jerusalem. And on the greatest day of the feast, Jesus stands and says these extraordinary words. And the way the gospel lays this out, it's as if in the midst of all the hubbub, he takes a place of prominence, raises his voice above all of the hubbub of celebration, and says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me. And let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture says, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." I was struck by that. Struck by it because of the preconditions. "Anyone who is thirsty, come to me," he invites. It's intentionally ironic. Because, of course, that's the time when there's plenty of food and plenty of drink. There's more than enough to go around. Everyone gets included. No one doesn't have a seat at somebody's table. They understood that the whole nature of the celebration was to include people, whether they had the economy or not, actually didn't matter. They were fellow Jews. They had come to celebrate, regardless of their nationality, as was read, Parthians, Medes, people from all over the known Mediterranean world were gathering for that celebration. If you needed a place to come and eat Thanksgiving, come to our house, was in essence the way they celebrated it, and appropriately so, because what bound them together as a nation, as the people of God, was far more important than their economic stance. This was not a time for social snobbery. This was a time for inclusion, and everybody was welcome. So Jesus obviously means something other than physical thirst, right? Because all of the food and the wine were there. No, he's trying to tap into something that is deep within the human heart, a kind of inner longing that says, in the midst of even this great abundance, there's something in here that is not right. There's something in our world that is not right. And I long for God to come and slake the thirst that is deepest within my soul. There's a little chorus that goes, "All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. In the waves of his mercy, his deep cries out to deep, singing, come, Lord Jesus, come." That's the cry of someone who hungers for the very gift of Pentecost that we celebrate. Pentecost, quite frankly, does not come to the satisfied. Pentecost does not come to people who think their life's in actually pretty great order, thank you very much, and really see prayer as somehow a little bit of a divine energy that I need to be able to get through my day as it is presently organized. My commitments as they are already put in place. In other words, it's the icing on the cake that I need to be a better me. Pentecost doesn't come to people in that sort of circumstance. Pentecost comes to the thirsty. Pentecost comes to men and women, young and old, of every tribe, tongue, race, language, and nation, to say, there is something deeply amiss. And even though the fears and the rumblings within my own heart would be what I wish weren't there, I'd much rather have a kind of normal, regular life, you know. How are you? I'm fine. And actually mean it when I say it. It is exactly to that cry that exists within the human heart that the Holy Spirit desires to come and minister. All who are thirsty. So what actually I would like to do is briefly walk over to the piano. I'll be the voice over there that you won't be able to see. And just sing the chorus once as a way to invite us into a place where we're willing to be open. Something deeper than my, I'm doing great, thank you. How are you? How are your kids? So that there might be that openness, God being our helper, to be able to minister to the deeper place that in fact is existent in so many of us, unless there is a kind of hardness of heart that protects ourselves from such divine intervention. It is possible, you know. You can live a kind of ordered life in such a way, and I mean be a churchgoer, where in fact you're the queen of your heart. You're the king of your existence. And the last thing you want is for God to come in and upturn the apple cart. That would be disastrous. You've worked hard. The last thing I want is for my life to be disorganized. I work hard enough to keep it organized. Thank you very much. But I want to warn you, and I would be remiss if I did not say it. If you look at the lives of the disciples who gathered on that Pentecost morning, their lives were upended and publicly in front of all of their family and friends and neighbors. They were to many a public embarrassment. Ugh, they are just drunk. And at the first thing in the morning at that, completely mistaking and misunderstanding what's actually going on. If you want to be popular, if you want to be understood by everyone and admired, Pentecost actually is not for you. I wish that weren't the case. I really do. I'd long for an easy life, but it is not given to those who say yes to the Holy Spirit. The very essence of Pentecost is risk. Risk. So to open your heart means I'm actually willing not to be in charge. I'm willing to give it a try, God, to not be in charge. I'm not even sure I know what that means. But if the payoff is the sweetness of your presence, your power in prayer, for which I have always longed, an intimacy with you that I only hear about, maybe the risk is worth taking. The song. Apologies to the musicians. This is not the cream of all my heart, I assure you. But it is an expression of the heart, and that's what matters. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep,
We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. All who are thirsty.
See, those who had Pentecost had already offended most of their family just by being away and gathering to pray. Can you imagine what would happen at your house if on the Thursday morning of Thanksgiving you said, well, I'm not sure I'm going to be here today. What do you mean you're not going to be here? Half your cousins and your grandchildren are coming. Well, I've made this commitment. To who? Who's more important than your family? Well, do you remember Jesus? Yeah, he died. No, I've been trying to tell you, we saw him. And he told us to wait in Jerusalem. Yeah, but he didn't tell you how long, did he? No. And it's been a long time, hasn't it? Yes. See, we talk about a liturgical 50-day octave, but he didn't tell them how long they were going to wait. And what's supposed to happen? He said we would be clothed with power from on high. What is that? Well, I don't actually know. What do you mean you don't know? So you're obeying the words of a dead man, you're gathering with all these other people who are not members of your family, by the way, and you're giving up your family time to be with them as you have for the past several weeks, I might add, to the neglect of your responsibilities. And on this day, when all of these people are coming in to eat this huge meal with us, this big and extraordinary celebration, the biggest of the whole year, you're going to leave us and leave me to do this all by myself? I mean, how many husbands and wives have said that to each other? For a lot less than Pentecost. So you see, they had already paid the price of being, quote unquote, misunderstood when they had gathered together that morning. And they still didn't know it was going to happen that day. But they certainly felt the pressure. You see, what God had been doing is literally been weaning them over the process of those 3 weeks from every other affiliation that would take preeminence over Jesus himself, whether that be family, work, whatever the responsibility was. So that in essence, when Pentecost came, in the sense of the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, they were the, of all people, the most thirsty. Perhaps they'd even lost their jobs. You know, if you keep quitting to go pray, I don't know that I can keep hiring you, you know? You're not doing your work. But they were willing to take the risk, believing that somehow in the midst of their rather clumsy obedience, that God was going to do something in a way that they couldn't even ask or imagine. They didn't know what being clothed with power from on high even was, but they in fact waited for it, and God gave it to them in a way that was beyond anything they could have ever, ever imagined. New languages, the extraordinary, the city was at their feet. Peter stands up and preaches, thousands come to faith in Jesus Christ. The world is turned upside down. That's what it was said of these people who said yes to Jesus. Now, what does that have it to do, besides Pentecost, with the 140th anniversary of this parish and Jason Merbarger? Everything. As you know, because you've read the histories, Daytona wasn't like this 140 years ago, when a small group of people began to meet and pray. Morning prayer, somebody's house. And yet they dared to believe that God wanted an Episcopal Christian witness in this community. And at great risks and genuine personal cost, they gave financially and of their time and of their witness, for which we are presently the beneficiaries. I would want to say to you that in the midst of the extraordinary changes that have happened in this coastal community, for St. Mary's to take up that kind of mantle requires that same level of risk and that same kind of daring. The willingness to really pour into the scriptures and say, okay, God, who are we now? What would you have us become? What is the need in this community for the kind of gospel witness you would have us make? What is the unique gift that you want to do through us in a way that is, in fact, similar but different from other churches? Why are we here? Why did God decide in his economy that after 140 years, you're still going strong? Plenty of churches, as you know, have closed. It didn't have to keep going. But God said that it would, and it is. And that's why we're here. But I cannot tell you strongly enough that for you to understand that somehow your responsibility is to uphold a series of traditions that satisfy the people that are within this room but have no gospel impact on the community, you will die. You will die. There is a missionary imperative to Pentecost. You shall be my witnesses after this empowerment in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And so anyone with any prayerful sense at all in the midst of a community that is the inheritor of the Spirit would say, okay, God, where is our Jerusalem? Where is our Judea? What's the end of the earth look like for us? Where would you have us go? What kind of impact would you have us make on this community? That's the essence of Pentecost, because Pentecost is not about making me a better me. Pentecost is empowerment for service. That's its essence. And the extraordinary thing about service is that who are people who perform a service? They're what? They're servants, right? And who are servants? Servants who take their cues from their master. They don't do what they want to do. They do what their master wants them to do. That's the nature of what it means to be a servant. And so we're here as servants to say, we want this empowerment, God, so that we can be your witnesses, so that we can perform the service that you would have for us. I mean, the funny thing about being a servant is that you don't get to pick what your service is. Your master does. That's why you're a servant. It's not a negotiated settlement. You're not a co-equal with God sort of deciding what you will or will not do. Just the opposite. If we are servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, we have acquiesced that authority for ourselves and have said yes to him. That's what it means for Jesus to be what? Lord, not colleague. And the same is true for you, Jason. Jason, you are not here. Where are you? There you are. You're here to lead this congregation in those very questions. And the funny thing is that for it to be the Holy Spirit, there will be among the leadership this clear sense of, it seems good to the Holy Spirit and to us that we do this. And it may or may not look like what it's been in the past. It could. There is a DNA that God implants in a congregation. But Jason, it's your job to discern with them and to lead them in this new vista, whatever that might be. Whatever the Holy Spirit wants is really the operative question. What do you want, Holy Spirit? Not necessarily what I would like. But the good news is, here's the good news, is that the sacrifice is in fact worth it. There's a kind of completeness and a joy. There's a lift inside of your body that you feel when you know that somehow God is what? Carrying you along in the work that he would have you do. That doesn't mean it's easy. It's actually quite difficult. It's quite difficult. Do you hear me? It's quite difficult. It really does require risk, doing things that you're not used to doing, stepping out, like me singing as opposed to just starting the sermon. I knew I was supposed to do that. It wasn't just theater. It was my meager effort to be obedient. And that's all God asks of us, is the willingness to be obedient to what we are led, in fact, to do. I want to close with a poem by a wonderful poet that I know and like from England named Malcolm Geady. And it's on Pentecost, and the title of it is Our Mother Tongue is Love. Today we feel the wind beneath our wings. Today the hidden fountain flows and plays. Today the church draws breath at last and sings as every flame becomes a tongue of praise. This is the feast of fire, air, water, poured out and breathed and kindled into the earth. The earth herself awakens to her maker and is translated out of death to new birth. The right words come today in right order, and every word spells freedom and release. Today the gospel crosses every border. All tongues are loosed by the Prince of Peace. Today the lost are found, and all who know now the mother tongue, which is love, in every tribe and nation. That's the invitation. Not to do anything but yield and say, come, Holy Spirit, and see what God does. Amen.